and a very warm welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. A very warm welcome to our service this morning on the second Sunday of Advent, which tells you that there's only 13 days left of Christmas. 13 days, we're looking for some. Yes. And so I'm standing next to our Advent wreath. The first one was lit last week. I don't know what was said about it. We missed that bit of the recording. But I'm reliably informed that the second one stands for peace. According to the source I read, there's different versions of this. According to the source I read, last week should have been hope. This week's is peace, concentrating particularly on the Old Testament prophets. And the Old Testament prophets prophesied the coming of a time of peace, heralded by John the Baptist, and of course brought about by the great Prince of Peace. Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6, always read of at Christmas, says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." And when Jesus was born, one of the songs the angels sang was, "Glory to God," I'm misbeginning it right, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill to all men." So as we light, this is the one that was lit last week. The one we'll light this week stands for peace. And in the world we live in, peace is probably at times very much absent, both on a personal and individual level, but also in nations and between nations. So as we come up to Christmas, I think it is very important that we do reflect on the one who was called by the prophets the Prince of Peace. And indeed, in our reading this morning from the third chapter of Genesis, very early on in the Bible, we have the first prophecy. The very first prophecy of Jesus' coming, which tells you loud and clearly that Jesus' coming was no accident. Right at the very start, the prophecy about his coming was there to be read by all. So even when human beings fell into sin and to destruction, God prophesied the coming of someone who would change all that. And that's marvellous. And that's the one we have come to celebrate this morning, because that indeed was Jesus Christ. Now our first hymn this morning is an Advent hymn. It's the only one we're going to have today, so sorry if you were coming to expect singing Advent hymns all morning. Our first one is a well-known one, I think it is anyway. "Hail to the Lord's Anointed, Great David's Greatest Son." And the words are already up, so when Morax played the introduction, we'll stand to sing if we are able. Thank you. Thank you. Tam, one of the experts who was always wheeled out to speak on COVID matters, and the headline in the paper I thought was wonderful. It sort of screamed at me, seeing I was doing the service this morning, and it was 8 reasons we should still have a great Christmas. Now I bet you can't guess what was on his list. Acquired immunity, booster success, severe disease, tweaked vaccines, Britain's stable epidemic, uncertainty ahead, spread of response, lockdown unlikely. He's got a wonderful Christmas coming, hasn't he? 8 reasons we should still have a great Christmas. But where was Jesus Christ? Where was the birth of Jesus? Now, to be fair, I don't necessarily expect him to refer to that, but I thought, well, yeah, in our very secular society, it is forgotten about, isn't it, at times, that the real reason we have Christmas is not to go down to the local pub, well, many do, I'm not condemning that at all, but to celebrate the coming of the Prince of Peace. That great verse in Isaiah, "For unto us a child is born." That's the greatest celebration we can have at Christmas time. That's the real reason for celebrating Christmas, not tweet vaccines. But anyway, I'm having mine done on Wednesday, so I can't complain too much. Right, let us ask God's blessing on our service this morning. Let us all pray. Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we come together on this second Sunday of Advent to celebrate the coming of your Son as our Saviour, indeed the Saviour of the world. As the prophet Isaiah declares, he is our wonderful Counsellor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, and our Prince of Peace, the one who came from your presence to manifest, as we've just been singing, your fatherly love and forgiveness. Come, Lord Jesus, into our world of darkness and light up our lives with your coming. Fulfill our longings with the joy of your birth. Move us with your love so that our actions will echo your peace, that we may seek to bring tidings of comfort and joy to those we come in contact with who are torn by suffering and sadness. We ask this through Christ our Lord, the precious Prince of Peace. Amen. Right, the notices. Well, there's quite a few of them, so please take note. That's what you're supposed to do with notices. First of all, refreshments afterwards, so don't forget the refreshments afterwards. Coffee morning on Tuesday, 10 till 12. Ladies Bible study, apparently is 10:45 in the evening. Sorry, I only saw that last minute, so I didn't have a chance to get you to change that. Anyway, 10:45 in the morning.
It's not Bible study this week, it's ladies' afternoon in the afternoon.
Ah, well, see, I said it was, and Tim's changed it, so blame him again. That's what I put, you see. I put, was it 2 o'clock? And then when,
no, it's
on
1 o'clock.
1 o'clock?
Yes.
It's 1 o'clock. Oh, well, my time was wrong anyway, so. I thought it was Tuesday afternoon this week. So it's Tuesday afternoon at 1 o'clock.
1 o'clock.
Right, okay. Not 1 o'clock in the morning. 1 o'clock on Tuesday afternoon is the ladies' Bible study. If you are able to get there, please come and swell the numbers.
That's
still going to be fun. Oh, is it? I'm not invited. Sorry, bringing knives and forks in that case. Well, your Bibles as well, but knives and forks in as well. I'll pass on before I say anything more than what I'm saying. Right, oh yes, carol singing on Wednesday. Meet here at 6:30. We are joining, I think. I'm going to get this one as well, as you. Oh yes, yeah, I've got the thumbs up. So I'm right on this one. We're joining St. Luke's to go around the estate carol singing. So, can we swell the numbers, please? So as many as possible, if you can make it, and you've got your voice in good trim. I'm surprised mine's all right this morning for some reason. Then come down and enjoy singing carols in the pouring rain. What could be better? Yeah?
Afterwards, refreshment here in the
school room. Oh, well, a bit start. Well, possibly. Okay, so, afterwards. So 6:30 on Wednesday. Note it, please, in your diaries. Don't forget about it. Put it on your calendars when you get home. Fellowship prayer meeting on Thursday at 7:30. We had a good time of a Bible study around 1 Peter last week. So this week it's our prayer meeting. And then on Saturday, help is needed to prepare welcome bags for the new homes. Again, this is an activity with St. Luke's. I don't know if St. Luke's people are coming to... Oh, so again, we need to swell the numbers. We don't want to be in the minority as the Blackburn Baptist Church. So as many as possible, please, at 1 o'clock to help fill the bags. And then at some point in the next few weeks before Christmas, we will be going round to deliver them to the people, to the families who have come and started living in the new homes. And finally, next Sunday is our all-age Christmas communion service. I don't know if I'm supposed to say why it was postponed from this week. Nothing to do with me. I'm allowed to say.
Yeah, of course.
All right. It's because Victor and Nikki are coming, and she could not come this week. So it's an opportunity to welcome them into fellowship. They have been members of our church for quite some time now, but we haven't actually done it formally, you might say, at our communion, the time of communion. So it'll be a wonderful time next week to introduce them to our fellowship. Okay. So our all-age Christmas communion service next week. So please come and swell the numbers if you are able. Now, at this point, next point, is our offering. Can I have two volunteers? Is it possible to have two volunteers? Janet's volunteered, I know. Oh, and Howell, well done, thank you. And there's a gospel song that you can listen to as they go around. And this was wonderful. A 93-year-old lady singing a wonderful gospel song in her home to a bit of guitar playing. I'm sure you'll recognise it. If you do recognise it, you can join in. You can join in, okay? So, thank you, Tim.
I'm only human.
Bless them and use them to your honour and glory. In the name of the Prince of Peace. Amen.
Amen.
I now will ask Becky to come and meet.
Let us pray. Beautiful Heavenly Father in heaven, thank you that you are the light of the world, guiding our steps on your good path. Lead us, your people, to be faithful to you. Help us to be encouraged and changed for the better. Help us to be protected from temptation and complacency. We want to be a church filled with joy. We want to sing your praises together. And when we pray, we want to pray with confidence that you will fill us with your Holy Spirit. We are your children gathered together to worship, serve, and love you and each other. May we work together as members of one body, and use wisely the gifts and attributes you have given to us to faithfully love and serve one another, and you, our most precious Saviour. You know our every need. Let us remember that. Fill us with the knowledge of your love, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger. Give us boldness to reach others. You are able to do more than we ask or expect. Bless our church. When we are together, precious Father, you are in the midst of us. Strengthen our church, Lord. Let people listen and respond to you. Show us what we need to do, how to act to be attractive to our brothers and sisters. Please guide our tongues and our experiences of your greatness to those who have not come to know you yet as we know you. Help us to show friendship and compassion as you do, Lord Father. Show us the way to be your hands and feet and eyes and ears. Give us the confidence to talk about you and to tell people of your promises to us that we are never alone. Your promises are always faithful, and we need never to be afraid, that we can always trust you and depend on you. We pray this morning, Lord God, for all nations to live in harmony. Please, Lord, heal suffering and sorrow for all mankind. Give wisdom to our political leaders. Help them to make the right decisions. Give them courage and perseverance. We pray for the children who are unloved and unwanted. We ask you to let your love become known to those of us who are not aware of you at this time. Children who are abused and frightened. Young people who rely on drugs, who are hungry and angry all the time. Children of other lands who are recruited for war and taught to fight and hate. We pray as well this morning, Lord, for people who live alone. Loneliness is a terrible thing to conquer, and particularly when you live alone. It is easy to become depressed and frightened, especially if you feel unwell and you don't know what's wrong. Comfort the bereaved and suffering and lonely, we beseech you. Help us all to reach out to someone, even one person. How encouraging would that be to us if we could tell even one person what a wonderful privilege it is to know and love you. Indeed, Lord, we are privileged that we can openly come to your house of worship, that we can carry our Bibles with us and speak aloud about the wonders of you. We are very lucky too that we have a faithful pastor and deacons to reassure us when we are feeling lonely or rejected. We thank you for Alec and our church leaders and for all the work they put in behind the scenes. We thank you too for other ambassadors like Brian and Jackie Childress for the work they continue to do. As we are nearing to Christmas, we think about all the charities and aid workers who will try to provide for the less fortunate of us. Where would we be without our volunteers and people on the front lines? Please keep your protection over these people, Heavenly Father. Help the funding and let your word grow in these desolate places. We pray for patience as we once again are not certain what the next few months is going to be like. We know there is a different strain of the COVID to be worried about. This is a blow to everyone once again, especially people in the catering trade. Please, Lord, help us to bear this with tolerance. As I bring my prayers to a close, may we just reflect in quietness for a few moments on all those people, known to each of us, who need your healing touch. We will pray silently, and you, Lord, already know. Please place your healing hand upon them and let them feel your presence. Thank you that we can come to you with our prayers and anxieties and be sure that you will comfort us. Just have a minute. Ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Becky. God has many qualities, many attributes, but one this next chorus brings to our attention is that God is good. And that goodness was reflected yesterday, and I'd like to thank on behalf of Diaconate, all those who came down and decorated the church ready for Christmas. Whoever's done this clearly has the art of decorating. If I had done that, I've just thrown them on, and it would have looked like I'd thrown them on. But that looks excellent. A showpiece. You can come round to our house and do ours sometimes. So a great thank you to those who came down yesterday, gave up their time to decorate the church, and also those who came down on Thursday morning to help clean the chapel and to keep it looking decent. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, God is good. Thank you. Keeping time with the music, Colin. Thank you, Maureen. Wonderful at the end of it for us to reflect upon, but just to get us thinking in the correct way. We've all seen, I'm sure many of us have seen, the knife angel, even if you've only seen it on television or in the newspapers. If you've taken time out to actually look at it in town, I don't know if it's still there actually.
It has gone.
That's what it was like, and I took note. I looked in the news since I last spoke 2 weeks ago, and there have been two knifings, two terrible stories, literally in the last 2 weeks, just to show the importance of this statue and what it means. And both of these were terrible. I mean, every crime, every knifing, I suppose, is terrible, but there was something dreadful, wicked, evil about these particular crimes. The first one was of Steve and Jennifer Chappell. I mean, this was breathtaking, at their home in Somerset, as their two children slept upstairs. I mean, you can't believe it. And it was just simply a falling out over a car parking space. Every house had one car parking space. So if you had multiple cars, which is very common these days, it caused problems. Because very often there wasn't space in between on the road to park. And clearly there had been some tensions. But it meant that this person, an ex-neighbour, an ex-army person, I might add, had been arrested, charged with the murder. And you think, why? You know, is parking a car such a thing that it would lead to such a terrible event, leaving two children parentless? Just flat, in a moment like that, in a matter of a minute or two, rage. Terrible crime. And then, this was last Sunday, I'm losing track of time here. But a 12-year-old Ava White in Liverpool City Centre was stabbed to death by a 14-year-old boy after watching the switching on of the Christmas lights in Liverpool with friends. Again, why? Becky mentioned this in her prayer. She didn't refer to it by name, but I think she was referring to this particular case. If you've seen the papers in this last few days, they've commented on the murder of little Arthur Abinjor Hughes. And I find that story, I couldn't watch it. So utterly, utterly distressing. And if you went online, there was a video you could actually see of the little boy appealing for help, crying out for help, crying out for food. I mean, it's just utterly, utterly breathtaking. And it's these kind of stories which are not things that happened thousands of years ago. These are happening day by day in our country now. And people ask the question, I read an article yesterday by a well-known writer, and he was writing about this particular story, about this six-year-old boy. And he was saying that the shame of this event comes on this country and its reputation. We could allow something like this to happen. And he said everything apart from one thing. Why? He tried to give reasons. He tried to give sophisticated reasons, sociological reasons, psychological reasons. But ultimately, it was almost like he was trying to avoid the ultimate reason why these things happen. And why it is that terrible things happen in our world. For all people say about God and God doesn't exist and all and everything like this, you hear much about this these days, they still give the game away, so to speak, by the fact that they regard these kind of events as evil. That there's something fundamentally wrong. I mean, evolution doesn't teach you that. If you believe in evolution, you should expect it. It happens in the animal world. Animals kill each other left, right, and centre and think nothing about it. We get stories in the news about dogs killing children, and we seem surprised. That's part of the animal world, and yet we expect humans to behave differently. Why? Where does that come from? Now, clever scientists might give their reasons, but they've always fallen short. They always fall short, those explanations. Because deep down, inside the human heart, there is something crying out saying, it should not be like this. Humans should not be like this. But that begs the question, why? Why should humans not be like this? What has gone wrong? And the story we've been looking at this morning from Genesis 3 gives us loud and clearly the reason why this does happen. That we needn't give up hope, though we see these terrible things in our newspapers. Things that do depress us. No doubt about that. But there is, at the end of that Genesis 3, a wonderful expectation. Promise even from God himself that he will do something about it. And we come to celebrate the fact that he has done something about it in Jesus Christ. So, I'm going to ask at this propitious point to ask Jane to come up and give our read, not all of Genesis 3, but the first half of it. Thank you, Jane.
The reading is from Genesis 3, verses 1 to 15. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw the fruit of the tree was good for food, and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig tree leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, where are you? He answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree from which I commanded you not to eat? The man said, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel.
We watch a cartoon just to drive that story home, just in case we're off asleep this morning. That story had a reference this week. In my paper, it referred to it. In the, I don't know if you're following the trial of Ghislaine Maxwell, quite fascinating, but her lawyer referred to this story. It's amazing how often this story is referred to, even in the most obscure connections. She's been blamed. I'm not making any comment on this. Just the lawyer said, her lawyer said she's been blamed for what a man did. And then she went on, just like Eve in the Garden of Eden. It's one of those social cultural stories which keeps people referred to. It's amazing how many people know about Adam and Eve and the Garden of Eden and the apple tree and so on. Even though they may not know anything else. It's one of those iconic stories which we're going to look at this morning. But cartoon, please. Thank you.
God gave the first two people, Adam and Eve, a beautiful garden to call home. He gave them everything they needed, and he gave them one command. God said, you may eat from any of the trees in the garden except for one. The garden had a tree to call the tree of knowledge of good and evil. God warned Adam, if you eat from that tree, you will die. Now, the serpent was the most cunning of all the animals. One day, the serpent went to Eve. Did God really say you can't eat from any tree in the garden, he asked?
Eve answered, we can eat the fruit from the trees in the garden, but God told us not to eat from the tree in the middle of the garden. He said if we eat the fruit or touch it, we will die.
No, you will not die, the serpent lied. The serpent told Eve that she and Adam would be like God. They would know good and evil.
Eve looked at the fruit. It did look delicious, and she wanted to be wise. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Eve also gave some of the fruit to Adam, who was with her, and he ate it. Then their eyes were open, and they knew they were naked. Adam and Eve sewed together fig leaves and made clothes for themselves.
That evening, hid among the trees. God called out to Adam, "Where are you?" Adam said, "I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." God asked Adam, "Who told you that you were naked? Did you eat from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" Adam blamed Eve. "She gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it," he said. Eve blamed the serpent. "He tricked me," she said.
God said that bad things would happen. Life would be hard and painful, all because of sin. The snake would crawl on its belly and be an enemy to people. But God promised that one of Eve's descendants would destroy the serpent. Everything changed after Adam and Eve sinned. They were not close to God like before. Sin separated Adam and Eve from God. God made them clothes out of animal skins and then sent them out of the garden. God put angels and a sword of fire at the entrance of the garden to guard the way to the tree of life.
Ever since Adam and Eve sinned, all people have been sinners. Our sin separates us from God. But God still loves us. God promised a rescuer would come from Eve's family. God sent his son Jesus to rescue people from sin and bring them back to God.
Now, two children here, the two children at the back. I think you've got, there's a treat for you in the room, in the community room. If you want to follow that lady standing up there, she'll take you into the other room and you can do something fun instead of listening to me. See you afterwards. Right, just for a short time, I have three headings for you this morning, representing three main themes of our reading from Genesis chapter 3. They are the rebellion, the reckoning, and the remedy. Obviously, we can only cover these in a brief fashion this morning, because there are so many Christian beliefs that hinge on this very important chapter. My intention is simply to whet your appetite, so you'll want to study this great chapter in a bit more detail if you've not looked at it for quite some time. There is a lot in it, far more than I can really bring home to you this morning. And really, the chapter has a lot of, umpteen in fact, implications for human life and existence, even in 2021, past approaching 2022. In fact, I think it's more relevant now than it's ever been. Because there is a pride and an arrogance amongst human beings because of science and technology. And yet they are allowing more fundamental things about human life and nature to slip. So first of all, the rebellion. Let's start with our first heading. The picture we have here is of the serpent tempting Eve to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Traditionally, it has been argued, I've heard this argument many times, that Satan tempted Eve because she was, mentally speaking, sorry ladies, the weaker of the two. But I think we can dismiss this argument. I might be accused of sexism from time to time, but on this one, I'm going to stand alongside those who will argue that the sexist answer is not correct. But we can dismiss it because we equally argue the serpent went for Eve because she would be the harder of the two to entice. And if he succeeded with her, Adam would easily fall into line. All wives know that with husbands. And that's just, there's elements of truth with that, I think. So I don't think we should automatically think that the serpent went for Eve because she was the weaker of the two. That could be true, but equally it could be wrong. There's a good argument for saying it is wrong. Equally, we could dismiss the idea that Satan is a reptile, for he was no more a snake than he is a dragon or a roaring lion. These pictures in scripture are merely representations. I think what we are meant to learn from this story by the fact that the serpent appears like a snake, you might say, is the fact that he is sly and cunning, deadly, his temptations venomous. Nor was the tree, I suspect, even in the cartoon, an apple tree. I like apples. No, I don't think it was an apple tree either. What sort of tree it was, we are not told. We can observe five stages in this rebellion, what is often called the fall of man into wrongdoing, into sin. These stages entail the rejection of God's word, or the word of God, and God's command. The first stage involves doubt. Let us compare God's original command in Genesis 2, we read 2 weeks ago, with the conversation the serpent and Eve have together in this first part of Genesis 3. And note the differences. Is it possible to bring that up? If we flick forward, is it possible? I didn't really think about the technique. Yes, excellent, thank you. Now let's just read this very carefully, take time. Right? On the left hand side is the command or the word of God in chapter 2. I've got mine somewhere here. I'm going to volunteer to read it. Anyone want to stand up and read it for everybody to hear? No? Go on, who said that? Oh, Shirley. Right, Shirley, thank you.
The Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But when you eat from it, you will certainly die."
Thank you, Shirley. That was excellent. Volunteer for the temptations? Alright, Barbara, thank you.
The serpent said to the woman, "Did God really say, 'You must not eat from any tree in the garden'?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, 'You must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die.'" "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil."
Thank you, Robert. Just keep it on the wall for the moment, that particular slide. The first difference to note is how God is referred to. We noticed in chapter 2, and I made quite a big point about it when I spoke last time, is God is referred to as the Lord God in a very personal way. And this continues, actually, in chapter 3 after verse 8. But notice how God is referred to here. In this first part of our reading, the serpent and then Eve merely refer to the Creator as God. Not the Lord God, but as God. It's less personal, almost like the difference between me referring to Joy, she's not here so I can say it, my dear wife Joy, I'd never say that, but anyway, and referring to the wife. I wouldn't say that either, to be honest, but the serpent is in effect deflecting Eve, or downgrading, you might say, her relationship with her Lord by simply referring to the Creator as God. God is not being addressed personally, but instead he's being talked about in a rather theoretical way. It's as though the serpent and Eve think God is out of earshot. He's not listening. They are apparently not worried about it being overheard. And so this is theology at its worst. The personal God drops out of the picture and is replaced with just an abstract idea of who God may be, what God may or may not have said, or what God may desire. The second difference is that the serpent begins his temptation by misquoting, just take note of that, by misquoting God's command, by adding a not at the beginning of the command. He turns it from a positive to a negative. Very clever. We all do that all the time. If we want to downgrade something, we change it around, we twist it from being positive to being a negative. In order to make it seem a burden, an unfair restriction in some way, he tries to undermine thereby God's goodness. And also notice how he moves the phrase "of every tree" to the end of the sentence to emphasize this restriction, and omits the word "freely." Very cunning, very sly. Language is a very powerful tool, and the serpent knew that. From placing a doubt in Eve's mind regarding the word of God, the serpent then goes on to notice a full denial. Once he's created the doubt, he then produces a denial. "You will not die." In other words, he lies by claiming, contrary to what God said, that nothing bad will result from breaking the command. In the third stage, the serpent engages in a bit of distortion of God's word by suggesting that the Creator is withholding something good from them, forcing them to live in a state of incompleteness. If they just eat the fruit of all that will be taken care of, and they will enter into a new, higher level of existence. For they will become divine, notice, they become like God. It's as if he's telling Eve, God doesn't want you to be great, Eve, because that would threaten his greatness. But you can be great, Eve. God knows that you can be great, just as he is great, but he doesn't want that. And so, pride goes before a fall. The serpent has now planted a destructive seed in her mind. Fourthly, and the last one, we come to the deception. She determines for herself, rather than by following God's word, what constitutes good. Notice. Oh, it's not mentioned on there. I've missed that bit out. If you read the original verse, she goes on to say, she looks at the tree and notices how good it is, how beneficial it would be. And then, of course, we get to the fifth stage of disobedience, where she, along with Adam, disobey God's word and eat. Let me go back to the words, yeah, please. Sorry about this. Yes, the final one is the disobedience, where she, along with Adam, disobey God's word and eat of the fruit of the tree. The fact that Adam does not appear at any stage to question the action suggests to me that it was Eve who was the point of resistance, as I said at the start, and not Adam. Either way, they rebelled because they believed the serpent's lies. They rebelled because they wanted to believe the serpent's lies. And so they sold their souls to the devil. But Jesus reminded the people of his own generation, as he reminds us today, and every would-be charlatan who seeks power. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world but lose his own soul? Like Adam and Eve, we are called to live in God's world on God's terms, and not in a world of our own devising. Sadly, when some people hear that they must live on God's terms, they feel like their fun like Eve, will be spoiled and their freedom squashed. So how can we avoid that reaction? How can we get into a good place without feeling put upon, hemmed in or restricted? We avoid it by nurturing trust. When God says don't, we can trust that God has our best interest at heart. And when God says do, it's because he wants us to enjoy life to the full. He's a loving father who wants the best for his children. The opposite of trust, of course, is distrust and rebellion. So our first heading was, of course, the rebellion. Our second one is the reckoning, or the results of that rebellion. What are the results of their disobedience and the fall from God's grace? Overall, sin entered into the experience of Adam and Eve. They are now fallen or broken creatures with a tendency to seek the bad and avoid the good. Yes, they know what the good is, but what sin means is that there is a tendency in human beings, if they get the chance, to always prefer the evil over the good. That's why we don't have to teach children how to be bad or how to do wrong things. The opposite is true. We need to inculcate or guide children towards doing good things and building up good habits so that they recognize the good and to do it at all times and in all kinds of situations. And so there are, in effect, two main results of the fall. The first result is that Adam and Eve have now to live their lives in a state of estrangement or separation or alienation. There's lots of words you could use here. From God, their creator, separated from him. Their close communion with him in the garden, so exquisitely stated in verse 8. I love that phrase where it says that God walked in the garden in the cool of the day. I love that expression. It's a wonderful expression. The pre-existent Christ walking through the garden, seeking communion with Adam and Eve, and they hid. They hid. So that community is now fractured. We are alienated from his presence, and as a result we seek to create gods and idols for ourselves in our own image. Rulers, the Caesars did this, the Pharaohs did this, the president, the leader of North Korea does this. They want people to worship them as gods. That's always happened. Human beings then fulfill that role of being godlike. We are exiles from God's kingdom and the tree of life with no hope of immortality. By nature and practice, we are lost souls who are haunted by decline and death and the grim prospects of what could lie beyond the grave. The death that God promised in his command was initially spiritual in nature and then physical in the short to long term, depending on circumstances. As a result, death is the one certain fact of life, apart, of course, from taxes. And yet there is an emptiness, a God-shaped vacuum in the human condition that people try to fill in all sorts of ways in the hope of reclaiming the lost happiness. But these alternatives will always fall short and will fail to satisfy, and in some cases will eventually destroy people's lives. The second result is that there is now enmity and strife between the sexes, between humans in general, and between humans and nature, as we've been looking at recently in terms of the conference they had in Glasgow. Nature is no longer seen as a friend, but as an enemy to be conquered and treated with contempt. For all the promises of COP26, nature will still be regarded as something to be ransacked for the sake of materialism, without a proper understanding of our origins as based in Genesis, we will fail to credit the natural world with a sacred value. And finally, the remedy. On the surface, all this looks dreadful, but this chapter does not end on a sour note, but with a promise of deliverance. And this promise is particularly relevant as we are now in the season of Advent, with Christmas fast approaching. There are clear good news items in our passage, but it's just one I want to look at. The main good news is that the Lord God promises in verse 15, that's the verse that Jane read, to send a seed or child, a descendant, who will destroy the devil and everything he represents. This is the first pronouncement of God's loving plan to save humankind from sin and the effects of sin. For this reason, this promise is sometimes called the proto-evangelium, for want of a better expression, or the first gospel message. At Christmas time, we celebrate the coming of God's Son into this scene of time in order to be the saviour of the world. Jesus means saviour. He came to destroy the works of the devil, we are told. He still comes to break oppression, to set the captive free, to take away transgression and rule in equity. Through the life and cross work of Jesus, we will no longer need to be enslaved to the devil or entrapped in the kingdom of darkness. On the cross, Jesus destroyed, as we were looking at a few weeks ago when we studied Ephesians, the principalities and powers, the devil and his forces. His resurrection declares his victory over Satan. And as the victor, he can lead us also in triumph over the devil. We can be more than conquerors through Christ's overwhelming love for every one of us. So finally, notice what those three words that God shouted to Adam and Eve when he walked in the garden. Where are you? Where are you? And that is a question I feel that is coming down the centuries, if not the millennium, to us today. Where are you? Where are you? Are you in the kingdom of darkness or in the kingdom of light? Do we seek to hide from him? From God? Not by hiding in a garden, of course, but by melting away in the crowd. By our busy lives, hoping that God won't notice. We don't wish to become Christians, and so we distance ourselves from God's call. If we are Christians, we too may be hiding from God's plan for our lives. But God has provided a way out of our current separation and the darkness of sin that can so easily ensnare us, the Bible tells us, and into his glorious light through Christ. I pray that we will all respond with a yes to the offer of a new life in Christ, so that this coming Christmas we will have special cause to celebrate the coming of Jesus, not only into this world, but also into our lives through his Spirit, which is what so many of the carols we sing at this time bear witness to. The remedy. Where are you? I don't know where you stand in relation to God. I can't read your minds. I can't read your hearts this morning. But God can. And he knows where you are in relation to him. Are you hiding from him in some way? Or are you able, as it were, to look God in the eye and say, I am yours. I am yours. Our final hymn is a hymn of confession. It's a wonderful hymn. There's no greater confession in the Bible because it comes from the pen, so to speak, of King David, who did some terrible things. He was an adulterer. He was also a mass murderer to cover up his adultery. And yet, the Bible calls him the friend of God. Why? Because he realized he was a sinner and wanted God to forgive him of that sin. And God did that. We too, regardless of what we've done in the past, regardless of where we are today, can also get that, that good and faithful servant. We too can be friends of God. And this is a very powerful psalm, Psalm 51, in which David confesses his sins before God. And I want this to be personal to us. Say, not just by singing it with our minds, but also with our hearts. Can we do that, please, for the Lord's sake? Amen. Thank you.
Get it, we're able to stand. If you don't know it, it does repeat itself quite frequently. So.
Thank you.
say the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all and evermore. Amen. Don't forget the refreshments afterwards. Thank you.